It is my pleasure to preside over this afternoon session today. And as the morning session was very successful, we hope that the same success will continue. So, as my presentation will be tomorrow, and I intend to use fully my 30 minutes. I am not going to take your time today. And therefore, I start with the speakers. The speakers are all very prominent, and especially what I like here is that the whole Europe, from north to south, from east to west, is almost represented during this conference, of course, and even in this panel. So first I would like to give the floor to Professor Karla Tuori from Helsinki University. He is a specialist on constitutional law, human rights law, and as I know also on all matters European. So please, Europe is in, let's say, maybe in crisis, in turmoil. Now we would like to hear your views also. What is our present and what will be our future? You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairperson, for the nice words, and thank you, dear organizers, for inviting me to cross the Gulf, which I unfortunately do much too rarely. But thank you for this opportunity. I will also say some words about Europe, especially general principles of European law at the end of my presentation. But I will start with a more, let's say, conceptual discussion. I will speak a little about the relationship between the concepts of a concept, legal concept, and the concept of a legal principle. Then I try to distinguish between certain variants of principle, so to say, different concepts of principle which are around in legal theoretical discussion, and also before commenting on general principles of EU law, I will say something about the distinction between principle and policies, so dear to Ronald Walkin, and not perhaps equally dear to our friend Professor Aleksi. The discussion on principles has been affected by the polysemy of the very concept of principle. It can be even difficult to keep legal principles and legal concepts apart. And indeed, I think no reason exists even to strive for such a strict separation. In legal literature, the terms legal concept and legal principle are often used as synonyms. And this, of course, is a consequence of the particular normativity of legal concepts too, especially when legal concepts refer to clusters of norm. Take example, strict liability. The private law doctrine of strict liability. Strict liability is used and can be used both as a concept and as a principle. And indeed, German Begriffs jurisprudence or conceptual jurisprudence and also American conceptualism used both concept and principle talk. Even Buchter, who has been considered a father of Begriffs jurisprudence, from time to time define the tasks of conceptual jurisprudence, or what came to be called conceptual jurisprudence in terms of legal principles, actually. Different strands and eras in legal scholarship have had their predilections with regard to the at least partly alternative terms of legal concepts and legal principles. Natural law authors preferred principle talk. German and American conceptualism shifted the emphasis to legal concepts, as did the analytical school too. At present, we seem to be living in an era of principles. Thus, the role of principles in the systematization of law has grown at the expense of concepts. Post-analytical legal science prefers to organize normative material through principles rather than concepts. And after analytical critic of the excesses of conceptualism, concepts, legal concepts, have been left primarily heuristic task in legal practices. Then to the very concept of principle. Also, the concept of principle is used of diverse kinds of phenomena, of phenomena, and principle discourse has been conducted in different legal contexts. Thus, the principles of Dworkin or Alexi do not necessarily have much in common with, let's say, the general principles of EU law, as the European Court of Justice has defined them. As a fundamental preliminary distinction, I would propose that we keep apart on one side legal theoretical and on the other side legal doctrinal discussion of legal principles. The concept of legal principles used in legal theoretical debates and legal principle as a doctrinal concept used in the context of a particular legal order, like the EU law. I start with the theoretical, more theoretical concept of principle and end up then with some remarks on the doctrinal meaning of general principles in EU law. In legal theoretical debates introduced by Professor Alexi and his colleague Ronald Dworkin, legal principles have been used as the other type of legal norms alongside legal rules. But this is only one of the many senses of principle in legal discourse. The list of varieties of principles you see on the screen is not perhaps exhaustive, but should indicate the plethora of meanings. First, we have legal principles as legal norms applicable in legal decision making, and these I call decision principles. And this is the sense of principles which is used in the famous Dworkin-Alexi discussion. Then we have legal principles as arguments employed in interpreting legal texts, such as legislation. These are interpretative principles. Thirdly, we have legal principles as legal sources supporting decision norms, from where norms applicable in legal decision making can be drawn. And fourthly, we have legal principles which in a way summarize the normative contents of a branch of law or the legal order as a whole. And these I call general legal principles. As I said, the debate on legal rules and principles has focused on decision principles, on prima facie applicable norms in the context of legal decision making. Decision principles form part of the normative basis from which judges derive the decision norm for the case before them, the major premise of the so-called judicial syllogism. But principles accomplish important tasks even in the stages preceding the formation of a decision norm in legal decision making. And then they appear in the guise of source principles or in the guise of interpretation principles. So legal principles may provide source support for surface level applicable decision norms, which in turn may be either rules or principles in character. Legal principles function not only as independent legal sources, but also as arguments in the interpretation of other sources, that is, as interpretative principles. One and the same principle can, in certain situations, figure as a decision principle and in others as an interpretation principle. And here, of course, fundamental rights principles constitute a good example. They display such a dual character. They are legal norms obliging the courts and can function as decision principles, especially in the absence of other complementary legislation. In general, though, courts have recourse to fundamental rights principles not as decision principles, but as interpretative principles. And some legal systems, such as my own, the courts may even be legally obliged to do so, to use fundamental rights as interpretation principles. If we, in general, can speak of a basic meaning of the concept of principle, my candidate would be that of general legal principles. General legal principles, such as nulla pena sine lege in criminal law, or pacta sunt servanda in civil law, private law, or principles of detournement de pouvoir in administrative law, etc. General legal principles complement legal concepts as the other main elements in the so-called general doctrines, allgemeine Lehren, in different branches of law. It is, in general, legal principles which, so to say, are sedimented in the law's cultural layers, subsurface cultural layers. It is such general legal principles which bring about the coherence needed to secure legal certainty in a specific legal regime. General legal principles also constitute an integral part of lawyers' shared cultural pre-understanding, the legal pre-understanding through which we as lawyers approach distinct legal issues. However, of course, general legal principles principles also receive explicit discursive expressions in surface-level normative material, in court decisions, in legislation, and also in scholarly writings, for example, elaborating the general doctrines of a particular field of law, let's say, allgemeine Lehren of administrative law. In addition to rules and principles, there is another important distinction which Dworkin uses and which Dworkin, for Dworkin, is at least as important as that between rules and principles. And that, of course, is the distinction between principles and policies, or principles in the strict sense of the term and policies. Dworkin claims that principles in the strict sense of the term, it is principles in the strict sense of the term which connect law to morals and which also justify fundamental and other individual rights. Policies in turn relate to goals and instrumental strategic goals and programs concerning the desired state of society. Dworkin introduced also the distinction between policies and principles in the context of what I call decision principles. Decision principles were divided into principles and policies. But I would extend the use of this distinction between principles and policies also to the general principles which summarize the normative contents of distinct branches of law or a legal order as a whole. Individual branches of law can be more policy-oriented or more principle-oriented. Such branches of law as, for example, general criminal law or family law or even constitutional law, they are typically more principle-oriented, whereas branches of law like economic law, Wirtschaftsrecht of Deutsch, or administrative law are more policy-oriented. Indeed, one very important strand in 20th century legal theory, a very important strand which, however, often is neglected, discusses the bifurcation of law, which is typical for 20th century. Actually, we have many versions of such a bifurcation behind which I think we can discern, if we want, the distinction between principles and policies, and the distinction between more principle-oriented and more policy-oriented branches of law. I only give you a few examples of such thesis of bifurcation of law. There is Roscoe Pound's coordinating and subordinating law. There is Lon Fuller's law based on the idea of reciprocity and law as a form of managerial control. There is Hayek's famous distinction between rules of just conduct and rules of organization. And of course, there's always also Habermas' distinction between law as an institution and law as a medium, a distinction which Habermas introduced in 1983 in his Theorie des Kommunikativen Handelns, and, in my mind, too hastily threw away in his Faktizität und Geltung. Now we know, though, Dworkin's distinction of principles and policies, or related distinctions, are widely used. They are far from unanimously accepted. As I said, Robert Alexis accepts, as I can understand, the distinction, but with some reservations. He doesn't buy the idea of principle-based rights as absolute trumps of policies summarizing collective goods. But in the American, and here Alexis, of course, has been quite harshly criticized by the Habermasian school, Habermas and Günther and Frau Maus and so on. In the American discussion, peculiar alliances have been formed. So that, for example, Richard Posner, the leading exponent of the law and economics school, shakes hands with critical legal scholars such as David Kennedy and Martti Koskenniemi. Both these critical camps claim that principles are reducible to policies, and even the very distinction between principle and policies is policy-based. Well, time does not allow me to explore the argument in depth. Let me only state that I do not find it convincing myself. I retain the distinction between principle and policies. The distinction between principles and policies, I think, is also pertinent in examining such an epitome of transnational law, such an epitome of functionally demarcated field of transnational law as EU law, and also in examining EU law's relationship with member state law. I would argue that in state law, in member state law, when discussing EU law, the general legal principles are typically closer to Dworkin's morally laden principles than policies. The same principles, morally based principles, also lie at the core of what in EU law contexts has come to be called the constitutional identity of the member states. Member state constitutional identity is principle oriented. That is my claim. By contrary, when we approach EU law as a distinct legal order, I would say that what is typical of EU law still is typical of EU law and distinguishes it from member state law is its pronounced policy orientation. This policy orientation, of course, is most conspicuous if we talk at the constitutional level. This policy orientation is most conspicuous in what I call the EU sectoral constitutions, such as the EU economic constitution, the EU security constitution, and also the EU, to a lesser extent, maybe the EU social constitution. But this policy constitution, policy orientation, has also affected what I call the juridical constitution of the EU. Such key principles of the EU juridical constitution as the principles of direct effect and supremacy were originally motivated by clear policy considerations, by the need of the effective and uniform application of European law, which aimed at establishing the common market and guaranteeing its functioning. Accordingly, the substantive coherence which EU law has achieved has been a result of rather policies than principles. But of course, there's an important field of the juridical and political constitutions of the EU where EU constitutional law shares with its national counterparts a principle orientation, and that is, of course, EU fundamental rights law. As we know, preserving normative and interpretive autonomy of the EU was a central rationale behind the introduction by the Court of fundamental rights as general principles of community law. However, this need of normative and interpretive autonomy of EU law was justified in teleological instrumental terms. It also was considered as necessary to secure the uniformity and efficiency of European law, which the common market objective required. Thus, to put it a little paradoxically, the partial principle orientation brought about by fundamental rights, EU fundamental rights, was clearly and explicitly motivated by policy considerations, not with a reference to human rights, but rights as moral rights, but simple policy considerations. Especially before the relatively recent reinforcement of EU fundamental rights law, we can argue that the clashes of authority between European and member state law, which most dramatically have erupted in the relationships between the European Court and the German Constitutional Court, in these clashes, two different principle orientations have confronted each other. The policy orientation of European law and the principle orientation of member state law. This is one way of depicting the reservations that many national constitutional courts, not only the German one, but many others too, have made to the supremacy of European law. Constitutional courts have defended the principle-based foundations of national law against the policy-motivated claims of European law. How much time do I have?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. I make a simple solution. I cut the last part of my presentation, which includes a discussion of the notion of general principles in EU law, and where I repeat actually the claim I already made, that the principle used in this doctrinal, the concept of principle used in this doctrinal construction of European law, general legal principles of European law, has nothing to do with, for example, the Alexei Dworkin discussion. And what often really confuses writings where the concepts or principle is the concept of principles is used, and not only students' writings, but of course especially students' writings, but writings by established scholars too, is the ambivalence of the principle. The same writer can use without noticing it the concept of principle in very, very different meanings. So the main message that I want to leave here is to have more caution with the concept of principle.
I am also a timekeeper.